Subscribe to Jio Mami Mumbai Film Festival and hit the bell icon to keep yourself updated on conversations on Dial M for Films. Welcome to Dial M4 Films. Today we are talking about a life beyond cinema. Our guest, actor and entrepreneur Tapsee Pannu, is not talking about Vipassana or a Himalayan retreat, though those are important, but about creating interest beyond life in the movies that can both nourish artistic pursuits and provide a safety net that helps avoid desperate choices. Tapsee, thank you so much for joining us and for making the time.
Oh, my pleasure. Thank you so much.
Firstly, a very happy birthday.
I know
that we did not time the session around these milestones, but it is wonderful. It's a wonderful coincidence that we are recording today, a day after your 33rd birthday.
Yeah,
a day before.
If you would have asked for 1st of August as a date for this session, I would have clearly refused. It's my personal national holiday on 1st of August. I officially don't work.
Amazing. Good decision. And a day before the second year anniversary of a wonderful film that you were part of, Anubhav Sinha's Mulk.
Yeah.
And a month back on the 1st of July, your first film, Jumandi Nadam.
Yes.
Oh my God. Thank God I got this right. Itni rehearsal ki hai. I kept on calling it Jumanadi and my entire team was like, it's Jumandi, like, you know, Jumanji. So Jumandi Nadam.
It's Jumandi Nadam, but you were better than a lot of them.
Released a decade ago in 2010. What a fantastic run you've had in the movies. You complete 10 years this year. Congratulations, Tapsee.
Thank you. There were a lot of reasons to celebrate this year. But all thanks to this lockdown, I don't know what am I doing with those celebrations. I'm just waiting for it to get over to re-celebrate them properly. My 10 years in cinema, to my birthday, to such a wonderful post-Thappar time for me. I'm
Absolutely.
Not going to celebrate things because of this lockdown.
Listen, you need to now do double, triple, you know, quadruple celebrations. Come back with a vengeance because this is such an important milestone year for you. And of course, Thappar was so widely appreciated.
Yeah.
I guess you just have to defer it to next year.
Post-lockdown, I'll be aggressively celebrating.
Go for it. We'll join you on some of those. Listen, I wanted to dive in by just saying that, first of all, yes, it is a celebration of 10 years of you in cinema. Your life is about, you know, seizing opportunities. You've never let one go. You are an engineer by education, a trained Kathak and Bharatanatyam dancer. Entering the Get Gorgeous contest on Channel V was a chance that you took. What were your first, what are your first memories of the contest? You know, the reason I'm really curious is because I really want to know what the first brush with the world, this world, feels like for someone who did not nurse a long-standing ambition of being part of it.
You know, there were good and bad side of it. Good side, because you really don't see yourself at that point doing all this in long run. So you just seeing it as like one odd opportunity or something that you want to just experiment. So you just go with no insecurity or fear of losing. So that kind of makes you like really confident, that because you're like, you don't care, right? So that don't care actually adds up to your confidence that, you know, at max what will happen types. So I just went in with that attitude. But the bad side of it is when you see that you are such a mismatch amongst everyone who's standing around, you feel like that keep in the big city to the, you know, the odd one out in the room. I felt all of that because everyone was so well groomed and polished. And I had just given my sessional exams. I mean, anyone who's pursued engineering will know sessionals are like those in between semester exams that happens. So I had just finished that and I changed clothes quickly back home and I rushed to the Channel We Get Gorgeous audition venue, and all these tall, really model looking gorgeous women there, and I like one nerd is sitting there with my boots and totally wrongly dressed with like horrible dressing sense. The only asset I had at that point to fraud was my confidence that, you know, okay, I'll get through. It's okay.
I'll bring it.
I remember the person in the jury sitting there looked at me and like, you need to get rid of that belt and those boots. I was like, I want to dig a grave and just somehow in it for good right now. Okay, I mean, I was not taking it to heart because as I told you, I was not thinking of it to be a long-term thing. That kind of gave me confidence. So, okay, it's just an experience. Learn from it and move ahead. I tried. That's how...
How lovely that you turned that into, you know, sort of an asset. That let's see if this works out. Great. If it doesn't work out, it wasn't in my scheme of things. You know, I'm pursuing a degree. But, you know, pursuing a degree brings me to, I know that Get Gorgeous worked out for you. You were part of the finalists and, you know, it landed you. You started modeling because of that. You know, you got opportunities. But you insisted on finishing your degree despite a thriving, stint in modeling and an acting offer on the table, you know, as a result of the fact that you got noticed because of the modeling gigs that you did. You know, when you are young, you don't have this kind of foresight, but what gave you the foresight to complete your education?
Because I, first of all, I don't think that only one profession or only one career option can be the be-all and end-all of your life. I don't know if it comes from the fact that I've always been a jack-of-all-trades, master-of-none kind of a person. But I just feel that life is too short and you can't just get attached to one particular thing so badly that you feel that there's no life beyond it. So while I was doing my engineering, I realized in my second year that maybe this is not something that's exciting me enough, but I'm not going to keep dragging along just because I've gotten into it. I'll finish it in a respectful way, but I'll do something else after that, not to crib for the rest of my life that I made one wrong decision and then I have to stick to it. So that's why I started modeling. That kind of worked out really well. I was shooting almost like twice a week while doing my engineering. Was quite a big surprise for everyone around at that point because I was not really trying too hard. I've always felt my luck line is stronger than my lifeline. So I guess that's why it's working out all fine. And it took me like my final year. By final year, I started getting movie offers and I was like telling them, I don't know how to act. I genuinely don't because I guess I'm a trained dancer, but I don't know how to mouth lines. So just owning it up right there so that later on you don't tell me that I claimed otherwise. So, but then all of them still seemed excited to have me on board saying, okay, we'll teach you. So I was like, okay, fine, great. But then I had to finish my engineering because A, let's just accept I am a nerd. I like studying. I really enjoyed my front bencher position. I was a teacher's pet. For the longest time, except in college, because at that time I was barely in classes, but still I used to score pretty well. So I really enjoyed my maths. And so that's why I was like, let me just finish it. Now I've worked really hard to get into an engineering college, which is very difficult to get into a reputed engineering college. So I will finish it properly. And then it will become my backbone. Because I know once you've scored a decent score in your engineering and you've got that solid degree in hand, you always have this strong backbone saying, come what may, this is not going to go anywhere. You can always fall back on it and it's going to have your back and it's going to stay there. It will be like a proof for yourself and for everyone else around of what credibility you have. So that kind of gave, and I was very clear that I will do that. Plus, of course, I have my typical middle class family who was getting like petrified and like getting scared that this girl isko famous hone ka keeda kaat gaya hai, ye pata nahi kya karegi. And my dad, nights, he was like, I used to sleep and he'd be like stressed sitting on the bed, not knowing what to talk to me about because he didn't have a logical connotation of why not that kind of. And I said was, give me 1 year out of my life. And if it doesn't work out, I'm going to come back and do my MBA. I was preparing for my MBA, my CAT. So it was just out of the blue for everyone. And I told them, I'm going to get my degree sorted. I got my distinction after my final year. And I in fact secured a position in Infosys as well. Not yes. because I was very clear of not joining my job. I secured the position in the first company that came in my third year, not even my final year. My third year, Infosys came in for campus placement, and I secured yeah. a because only to show that if I want, I can get this. And to obviously give myself confidence as well that if at any point I feel I don't have a way ahead, I can always come back here. So all securing all these fallback options is when I moved ahead into my experimentation world of cinema.
I like that. You know, coming to that, I just, you know, when I was talking about the fact that you finished a decade. Now, the thing is, today you're successful, sought after, the roles being, you know, written for you. But there is a decade long journey, you know, and there is a potent journey that has brought you to this place. And if it has been rewarding, I'm sure it must have been very hard as well in parts. What were the biggest challenges you had to overcome and how did you overcome them?
You know, the biggest challenge was to either accept that you went wrong, you know, that at different stages, you know, be it in the beginning when things don't work out. For me, the beginning was really good. I think that is where the things started messing up with my head because my beginnings were really good. And I thought, okay, you know, without much of an effort, the beginning seems to be nice. It'll be convenient and comfortable to stay through. So that's what I think messed it up for me because after my good beginnings, things started going downhill because obviously I was not prepared for it. And I got it too easy to begin with. So that I think messed up things a little bit and made me feel the struggle real close. So that is the part that I had the tough time dealing with, where I had to accept that, okay, I went wrong. Okay, I had wrong expectations or I was not prepared. I had to accept my flaws and my mistakes and then think about future. Like how my basic fundamental has always been, at max, what will happen? At max. You just think of that. At max, what will happen? I'll not get killed, right? If my next 5 movies don't work, no. Will my life end if my next 5 movies don't work? No. I think I'm better than this. So let's just go ahead and dive into it. And come what may, I will sail through. I will float, if not swim. I'll dive in the deep end and I'll float.
But you know, Tapsi, this self-awareness, you know, where you said that, you know, my beginning was really good, I got it really easy. And then there came a stage where I felt that I'm slipping up. Now, this is a very scary space for a successful artist. Like what tends to happen is you have enablers around you. You have people around you that consistently tell you, which is also good in a way. But then sometimes it hampers self-awareness. How did you become aware of the fact, like what made you think that you're slipping up?
How did I become aware of this industry, you know? I think it helps you grow up. This industry makes you a matured person faster than a lot of other professions, I feel. Because of the number of people you meet day in, day out, be it because of that trust factor that gets broken and made every day. There are a lot of these reasons, but this industry helps you mature faster. But the point is, are you ready to learn from it? Or are you going to just like have this delusional wall in front of you? So as I told you, I think one factor that really helped me was that I never was too attached to this one side of my profession. So I always was like very, I used to see it very objectively that if this doesn't work out, I have to move beyond it. I'm not going to get personally attached to it and spoil the rest of my life. So that objectivity came from the detachment aspect. I think there was one of my colleagues, Kirti Kulhadi. She mentioned in one of the interviews, she was with me, I remember, she mentioned it to the interviewer when they asked her, what is the one good or one bad quality about Tapsi? And she was quite quick to say, I don't know if she felt it was good or bad, but she did mention that I can detach myself very easily. I think that really helped me to see things objectively at a very early stage. And I did get carried away in the beginning with the ease with which things were coming to me. I had signed 3 films before my first film released in South. So I was getting things pretty easy. But those 3 films that I signed or whatever I took up in the first 2-3 years of my career was basis the impression or illusion of people who told me that this is how it's supposed to be. This is how you're supposed to go through if you want to become a big actor, a big heroine here. And I just did not use my brain, and nor did I know any better, because I never planned this career for me. So I just went with the flow of everyone else's opinion of how I should go about without using my own brain. And I'm not saying they are to be blamed. It's me who's to be blamed because I didn't prepare myself well for it. And I was just like blindly following some other actress's graph. Like, okay, so-and-so actress did this, and see, she now eventually is here. So you have to also get through all this, and then you'll eventually reach here. But the same formula did not work out well for me. So the fact that I was not getting, aggressive about, okay, no, I'll keep doing it. You know, I want to become the next Amitabh Bachchan or a Shah Rukh Khan who will keep trying and keep going on for like years and years in spite of the failure in a particular direction. I was very, very clear that there is one Shah Rukh Khan when there were thousands and thousands of other people who took the train back home. So I can't keep pinning my hope on being that one Shah Rukh Khan or one Amitabh Bachchan, you know, there. So I need to be very aware, or for that matter, one Priyanka Chopra. So I can't be that. So I have to be very objective and clear and make my own path rather than trying to say this is my path, what Amitabh Bachchan did, what Shah Rukh did, what Priyanka did. So I think that objectivity was because of the detachment that I have with things I do.
So basically, without listening to, I mean, you could see it. You could see that something is amiss. And you could see it only because of the fact that you objectively viewed your work and not particularly only listened to, the noise around you.
Yeah.
That you could see it. You could see that something's not about right.
Yeah.
Was this around the time that you actually, because I remember we were chatting and we spoke about your experience with Chashme Badur, where you said that such a reputed director directed that film. It was a commercial success. And you felt incredible doing a Hindi film because the language barrier was not there. Mm. And you could suddenly get the sense of how amazing an experience it would be if you didn't have that barrier and you could do what you did there. But unfortunately, the film did nothing for you.
Yeah.
You know, it kind of did not, it didn't create a dent for you or a place for you as an artist in the Hindi film industry. Was that the time where you decided to kind of become proactive and take things in your hands?
Yeah, roughly around the same time, because Chashme Badur came 2013, which was roughly the third year of mine in the film industry, where I was still trying to figure out which direction is really working for me. And obviously, when you are still trying to find your ground and suddenly you get an offer of a David Dhawan film, you know, a director on whose name people go and buy a ticket, me being one of them, why wouldn't I take it? So I just jumped on the opportunity and I took it. And I still did. I don't regret doing it, because if I didn't get that mainstream start, I probably wouldn't have been this midway ground between the mainstream and not unconventional films and roles. So thanks to that kind of a start. So I did start there. But, you know, soon what I realized was there are way too many. This pond is full of these kind of fish who are like, sailing in the same direction and doing the same kind of stuff, and you're replaceable, and there are many who are doing it better than you. Let's be very honest. I've always said that I'm not the most drop-dead gorgeous looking woman in the industry. There's so many beautiful divas out there and doing this kind of commercial heroine stuff much better than me. And I was, again, I saw myself be too replaceable at that moment when I did Chashme Badur, that, you know, like, okay, this anybody could have done. What's so special? Why should people reach out to you and not other 50 names that are already there before you? So that made me rethink of my path, that I need to create a niche for myself where people believe that me, and to a certain extent, only me, to a certain extent, I'm not, everybody will eventually get replaced, let's be very honest. But to a certain extent, they feel that it's, I will do the justice, the best possible justice to a certain role. and that's why they should come to me and stick to me or wait for me. I shouldn't be replaced because of dates issue. I shouldn't be replaced because so and so people doesn't want me to be there. So I need to be a certain irreplaceable name in the industry for me to have a longevity. I think that is where it clicked. And that's when I took that baby's 7-minute role and then Pink and then so on and so forth.
Yeah, because you then created a path for yourself, which was very different. You know, you charted that out because I remember you saying that, you know, with Neeraj Pandey, you had to really sort of, you know, go after that role to get that 10-minute role in a baby because Neeraj didn't know your work before that.
Yeah.
You know, you've broken a lot of age-old conventions in the industry. Of course, we spoke about one which is coming from a completely, I mean, you didn't know acting at all. You didn't study acting and you got into this profession. The second thing that everybody talks about is single-minded focus. You know, because they're like, it's like almost your rite of passage, but you don't follow that at all. You follow the opposite belief. You have a wedding planning company, the Wedding Factory, that you started in 2015 with your sister Shagun and friend Farah. You bought a badminton team, Pune 7 Aces, in 2018. And you're deeply involved with all three, you know, things that you do. How do you make it work with a thriving acting career? You know, the other two things that you are involved in.
Honestly, time management is an art. And I feel if that is an art, I think I am a decent artist in that. I honestly feel that everyone should learn that art regardless of whichever profession you are in, because that kind of really helps you keep your mind sane and at the right place at the right time. Because these two things that I started, my whole objectivity towards life became better and different when I started these entrepreneurial careers, so to say. When I started Wedding Factory, you know, to go to all these events and pitch a certain venue and get a certain deal out, where it's always, they always want to get pictures clipped with you, but it's very difficult to get money out of them. So it's always like, will you attend the wedding? And then they give me the job of the decor person or a planner. I had some really bizarre experiences, which, you know, helped me grow so much as a human being to know the psyche of people, how, where they come from, what kind of, what strata, what expectations, and wedding being such a big affair in our lives, being Indians. That's one business I knew is never going to face recession. Trust me, even in this lockdown, people are getting married. People are getting married. You know, we have to say that as a company, we had to take a call saying, you know, I don't think we should do this at this point. But it's not like we are not getting queries to do it. We were like, our labor has gone away. They've gone to their villages. But it's not like people have stopped coming and getting married. Just one business, even lockdown could not stop us. That I knew.
Very good call, huh? Very good call. Ki ek dukaan khuli rahegi, wo nahi band hone wala, chahe kuch bhi ho jaye.
On the other hand, when I started this badminton team, this badminton thing was always a loss-making proposition from day one. And it was purely passion-driven. And my father, being the person handling my accounts and everything, because I was a science student, I know zero about taxing and investments and nothing. I'm zero, literally zero. So he is the one who's been just giving me this disgusted look every time this whole topic of badminton team comes up, because he just doesn't understand this on paper. It's a loss-making proposition for years before you start making profit eventually if it clicks. But there was something in me that I felt, you know, this is really helping me channelize my, you know, the competitive spirit, the sportsmanship. I have been into sports since I was a kid. Different sports, not one particular sport. As I said, I've been a jack of all trades and master of none. But I love that whole spirit, the sportsman spirit, the fact you play a sport, a game. I've been always looking at sports stars as the real stars. I watch Asian Games, Commonwealth Games, like glued to the television. I watch it like that. So not just the main famous mainstream games, but I watched even archery for that matter. I sit and watch it. I like seeing all the sports. So I got this opportunity where I thought, okay, now that I can't become a sports star, let's own a sports team. So I thought, let's just try that.
And ये सोचा कि क्रिकेट तो सबने खरीद लिया, मैं बैडमिंटन की टीम खरीद लेती हूँ.
अभी रीच से बहुत बाहर है तो अभी बैडमिंटन पकड़ लेते हैं. But it has been, again, that was like a different world. Like when I went out to give presentations to my investors and I tried to tell them that, okay, you need to invest in this, it's going to grow, badminton is going to grow in India and all of that. They are just looking, first 5-10 minutes, they're ogling at you because, you know, it's very awkward to see the person you've been seeing on screen paying money, suddenly asking for money. So it's a very awkward a scene to be in. But after a couple of minutes, when I'm presenting them these figures and all this is going to come back, and then they want to have cup of tea with me and all of that, and then they'll get back to me. They say, okay, we'll get back to you. And then they say no. It was like, you know, Tapsi, you've created this whole so-called stardom for yourself. It's bloody not working. Who the hell says that stars get it easy? Who the hell says that? I have some really horrible, horrible meetings where I've given it all I have with full aggression of investment and all that, and it's fallen flat. So, when you're standing there, you just see life where the whole star drama just vanishes from your eyes and you see life as it is real. Now, I use all of these experiences and then probably, you know, this is like my learning and that I gain and then put it all out in front of the camera when I become an actor, and hence it keeps it real.
But Tapsi, you've answered my next question because I really wanted to know what it feels like when you go inside, when a star goes inside to negotiate. And now I've come away thinking ki hum to star bhi nahi hai, but mami ke fundraising meetings bhi yehi hote hain. Puri presentation karo, uske baad ek paisa nahi milta.
Don't even ask like this. I want to, next time someone tells me you are privileged because you're an actor and you get it easy, I'm like, next time you come to me with these meetings, you will know how privileged I am and how easy I get.
But Tapsi,
get me down from that pedestal immediately. It's like, you know, stop thinking that you are a star. Like, come down to earth. Now see.
But Tapsi, tell me something. For a person who did not train in acting, who came in, started learning on the job, and, you know, has created such a significant position for herself, does it not sometimes take away from focusing on the thing? I know you keep calling yourself, master of none. Of course, from where I am sitting, it doesn't look like that. But having said that, does it not take away from your focus as far as your acting is concerned?
No, it doesn't. Actually, it just sharpens my focus more because, when you are in that moment, when I'm at work as an actor, I am there fully as an actor. As I told you, I probably have been blessed with the art to disconnect. So when I want to disconnect, I will disconnect. When I'm on ground as a badminton team owner and I'm standing there biting my nails and getting stressed, I'm not thinking about how beautiful I'm looking on the camera, all stressed if my team is winning or no, because there I'm a team owner who is totally invested in the sport. So I don't get that baggage of being a star, so-called star or an actor there, because I know I'm a team owner there. When I'm at work, I remember this time Haseen Dilruba, I was shooting and my team was playing and I couldn't make it to the match because I was shooting, and I had one of the most critical scenes to do that day when my team was playing, and I can't, like, it's just such a psychologically difficult thing to say, okay, my team is playing a crucial match today, but I'm not going to watch it. So I had to keep telling myself, Tapsi, if you're going to watch it, it's not going to change the result. So don't your mind, don't divert it towards something that you can't change. But you can change the situation when you are in, you're acting, at least you have that under your control. You don't have that badminton match under your control right now. So I had to deliberately disconnect and perform there. And then when that scene got over is when I checked the score. So I think that somewhere that art of disconnecting, detaching myself, really helps me come with a stronger focus whenever I want to, you know, all these things. It has I've never felt digressed or, you know, felt that I've diverted my focus when I'm at one thing towards the other. I never felt it like that so far. I hope I don't in the future also.
You know, you spoke about desperate choices. I did, were there points, you know, where in your career, in your 10-year-long career, where you felt very strongly when things happened, you felt very strongly that, listen, I need, you know, avenue myself where I'm invested beyond being invested in this because I don't want myself to, you know, in the future, take a decision based on something that I wouldn't usually base a decision on.
It has actually happened not for the monetary purpose, you know, because I always felt that I'm not going to let this decide, my money decide my future course. If I'm happy doing something, I will make money out of it. Somehow I'll find a way. I was very sure about that. So money didn't make me do desperate decision making because of, you know, the fact I had a degree and I knew that I could do something else, not this. The only thing that helped, that made me, force me to do make desperate decision was that turn now, to keep rolling in the market. Mm-hmm. It was told a billion times to me. That, you know, even if you're not really sure about this film, just do it because it's just good to be visible. You know, your film is going to be coming out after a couple of months. So people are just watching you and, you know, out of sight is out of mind. You know, all that kind of stuff that I kept hearing for the longest time. So that kind of forced me to make a couple of decisions, which I was not really sure of until it just went all over the place and shit had hit the fan. And then I was like, you know, now it is becoming like a damage control, this, you know, being in sight and not off sight and all of that. So that time I thought, you know, no, it can't be like this. Let's concentrate on the quality over quantity and let's not make those desperate decisions because, you know, sometime down in life, I know I'm going to eventually, sometime, this will all get over for me, right? I don't know when, but it will eventually. And I'm very realistic about it that when I look back at it, I should be proud of that journey and look at the filmography or whatever I've done and feel, okay, you know, I did whatever I could best, whatever I could do with my life. And I did not make certain embarrassing, desperate decisions. So I need to be very wary of that. When I look at my life objectively, a couple of years down the line, I shouldn't feel embarrassed of it. So that's when I thought, okay, the money is not really an issue. Because my dad was always like, you know, we are a regular middle-class family, but it's never going to be like you'll have to work to earn your bread desperately. So if it's not working out for you, please come back. And I was alone in Hyderabad when I started my career. I moved to Hyderabad alone. So he was even more like telling me this regularly that, you know, don't feel that money is going to be a driving force for you. And I also was always had this back of my head that if I have a degree, the fact that I have given my CAT and scored an 88th percentile, I'm not useless. So let's just make the most out of this life. And just for the sake of passion or for the sake of this, how can I call it quit? How can I give up? You know, if you're not accepting the reality that life is showing you, it's not like you're a loser. It's actually life is giving you a hint to move in a different direction. And if you're not accepting that hint, then you are a loser. Then of course you are a loser and you'll stay a loser. So you need to take these hints of life very seriously and not get too attached.
Tapsee, if you could change something that might have made your time in the industry easier, or might have, you know, sort of not made you do mistakes or take decisions. You know, the wisdom that comes with years spent, but that wisdom is never I mean, not that anyone listens to anyone, but then the thing is that things that could have made things easier for somebody like you who came in, who did not have any background in the movies. Now, when you look back, what do you think were those things, if they existed, would have made your time easier here?
I actually don't know, because even the times that I felt that I was misguided or I made those wrong decisions, the fact that I did not have any family member to come back home to when I was in Hyderabad. Today, if I look back at them, I feel those mistakes were the ones who made me a wiser person. If I wouldn't have done those mistakes, I would have probably committed them later on. And then it would have been a bigger damage. And thank God those mistakes were done in the beginning and I got done with it. Because there's one rule in life I follow: never repeat your mistakes. Make new ones, like if you all have to. But don't repeat your mistakes. So I'm glad I made those mistakes, because then I'm never going to crib or regret the fact that I did not have a godfather or I did not have a guiding force in the industry. Because today, if I can take the credit of wherever I am myself and not share that credit with anyone or hold someone else responsible for my achievements, is because I have gone through it by myself, making my mistakes, learning from it and all. So that kind of like makes me feel nice and happy when I look back at it right now. But at that point, I would have been probably saved by if I had the right guiding force telling me something about what happens in the industry. Because I had nobody. Like, my family doesn't even watch films. Like, they are that oblivious of this world. So my father is like, if you're eating food, lunch or dinner, whatever's coming on television, he'll sit and watch. Even till date. I don't think he's even seen all my films. He's that oblivious of this world. So coming from that kind of family, it would have been easier if I would have known that, this stays for posterity and you need to. Yeah. Yeah, and you need to make
the space for posterity is my favorite. I think that's a t-shirt that should be gifted to a lot of people. Just to remind them, whatever you might do, you might be rolling, be visible.
Passing shot, even that is gonna stay for posterity.
For posterity. You're absolutely right. We are all a sum total of our mistakes and what we do post that. But in terms of, the conversation that's been going on in the industry, if we were to look at it constructively, as opposed to the, vitriolic and misguided discourse that's going on, if we were to look at it constructively, just in terms of logistics, callbacks, telling people things on time. Do you feel systemically there can be improvements that might make it easier for somebody to navigate this place?
No, on one side, I do believe we should all make our mistakes and learn from it. Yes, I do. But on the other side, I feel let's not be harsher or make things more difficult than it already is for people who are entering the film industry and trying to make it on their own. Let's be mindful of the fact that we are coming with a clean slate with no support system in place. Things can be better and kinder. Of course, there's always a scope of improvement, especially when it comes to just not hand-holding, but at least acknowledging or, giving a chance of fair play. More often than what it is right now. So that can obviously, because everyone, I can't expect everyone to have such a solid mindset saying, okay, I don't care how many times you are unfair to me, I still come back and give it all. Not everybody have that. I also have my good or bad days, the bad days where I feel I'm just going to leave. It's not worth my time and attention. So it varies for everyone. So obviously, it will be better if we have a fair play platform, or if we have kinder people to deal with. And you're like, for example, I'll tell you, when Chashme Badur happened, and as I told you that it didn't work for me, thank God for a career in South. Thank God for that. I really am thankful that I did not destroy my confidence after that film, because people were not really responding well to me as an actor, because I had a very, very accomplished casting director sitting across the table after Chashme Badur and telling me on my face that I love the film. Everything else worked for me in the film except you. So imagine a one film old actor, you know, who hears this and is like heartbroken that this is it. It's such a big casting director is coming and telling me that I was the only one who stood out like a sore thumb in the film. My career, I'm not worth going ahead. So thank God to my South career is why, because I knew I've done like a dozen films there. So it's not like this person's statement is the be all and end all of my career. I have made it somewhere in some industry, so I'm not that bad. Imagine a girl who wouldn't have done all of that, and this is the first film, and this is the reaction you get from a big casting director. It can really break a lot of hearts. So we need to be slightly kinder to people, especially who are coming from no background, who haven't tasted this uncertainty and this. Because I feel, you know, the edge, forget about all the opportunity edge that people from the industry have. I feel the strongest edge that they have is that they've seen through their families how to handle these pitfalls, how yes. to handle failures, how this too shall pass and let's not take it to heart kind of a scenario. We as outsiders haven't learned that. We take our failures too much to our heart. It really hurts us and we keep holding on the grudge for a very long time. Unlike, you know, the star kids. So if there should be someone not be so harsh on us in the beginning, it might just make things better for a lot of us.
I mean, what you're trying to say is that, you know, don't hold back your opinion. But there's a lehza in which that opinion yeah. can be expressed so that it doesn't kill your spirit.
Yeah, true.
You know, could mean,
you can always, obviously, you could have told me that, you know, I saw the film, it was great, you know, I couldn't really connect with you as an actor, or you were the only thing that didn't work in the film. It was slightly harsh for a casting director to put that across. You know, not everybody would have been 12 films old like me at that point to survive that kind of a comment. So every time I also remember it, not because I have a grudge against that casting director. I honestly don't believe in keeping grudges. That's what I've learned from the Star Kids. Because you need to move on and you need to forget about all of that. Otherwise, you're going to keep holding on to it and it's going to hamper your journey ahead. I don't want to do that. But I remember it only because I want to be mindful that I'm not a casting director, but in whatever capacity, I should not be this hurtful to a person who's starting off in any way. So that, I think, will be a nice place to begin.
You know, there were a couple of, I mean, of course, things have changed now. People have started listening, but there were also incidents where there were things that were altered and you were the leading lady, but nobody felt that they needed to tell you.
Yeah, I remember telling you that. That happened in South, in a film that I signed for a role which was not like a full-fledged 2-hour role. It was, a supporting character, second lead, as they call it. And I was, my beginning introduction scene was changed without my knowledge. And I get to know it while we are filming it. Because I was like, they told me, okay, this is what you have to do. And I'm like, oh, okay, but this is not what I was narrated. And they're like, oh, we changed it because, you know, we had a discussion with Hero and he felt we should change it. And I was like, okay, but why didn't you tell me? Forget about asking me. Why didn't you tell me this before? And I was given an answer saying that, oh, I didn't know that I had to tell you. So that just made me feel so insignificant at that point that I'm like, I'm just a mere pawn and a very insignificant one that who's not even supposed to be told what to do and just do it, however we say. That had happened. You know, there are a couple of times my checks have bounced just because they don't have the budgets anymore to afford me after finalizing a certain amount because the hero's previous film hasn't worked or the producer's previous film hasn't worked. So the budgets have changed and I'm the one, being the female actor, have to compromise with my salary, not the hero. So, you know, like all these things, if you're not available on a certain date, you are changed. But heroes' dates can't be changed. Even a comedian's dates can't be changed. A comedian has committed to a certain date, we will be using that person's date, but heroine will be the last person to be casted. And whoever fits into that date is just cast. So I've seen all of that, gone through all of that, which kind of like doesn't make me feel disappointed anymore at any of this nonsense that happens nowadays.
You know, Tapsi, the other thing, I mean, of course, people appreciate your work. You've been lauded for the roles that you've played, and you've almost, you're the go-to person for anything, any deep dive that anybody wants to, you know, create on screen.
Any breaking that needs to happen.
Yeah.
On screen, any breaking that needs to happen, break the character, break the stereotype, break the head of a person. Go
on. Or do a film like Game Over. I watched it and I had my head down most of the time.
In that film. So breaking leg. Break a leg in that film.
Jump off a building. Get burnt. Yeah. I was like, what is going on?
All destructive things are coming.
No, so I want to know this. And I've keenly followed this narrative that a man is a perfectionist. And a woman is difficult in our industry for the same reasons, right? Mm-hmm. Why is a female actor a pain for asking questions? Despite what she brings to the table after those questions are answered?
You know, it's simple. Because for decades, we've had this prototype of a female actor who will just come with the mother on set and just like take care of her juice and food and... dress up in the best possible clothes and makeup and show up and perform as per told with no questions asked, no requirements whatsoever. This has been a prototype for decades. Now to suddenly expect it to change overnight is kind of unfair to humanity. So I guess that's why it's taking time and that's why, but a lot of us are relentless in that respect. And I have found this. You know, I used to be the most short-tempered person around in my family. Being a Leo and that too a numerological number one, my parents thought that there is no point even messing with this one because she's just born to fight. They just gave up on me on that. So though I am like that, but I have developed this insane amount of patience in this industry. Then now I have cracked this knack of how I'm going to question and point out the problems without offending people. I think I've cracked it. Because last couple of years, I've questioned a lot of things and I've had this very intense discussions with films I have done or doing, or the ones I've said no to also. I've had those discussions both ways. Very rarely I've had very weird reactions. I think it was only once that I had a very weird reaction from a director. I said that, you know, I want to know why is this character doing this and all. I'm not able to understand the logic. And then I got a reaction saying, I'm not going to change anything if you want it this way or that way. And I'm like, I'm not asking you to change anything. I'm just asking you, why is it like that? So very rarely I get this, not very often. You're mute.
Now?
No, you're mute again. Someone doesn't want you to talk. You see, someone doesn't want you to talk. This is the conspiracy of the universe.
It is. I was thinking, puri hamari meeting mein, pure hamare session mein light nahi gayi. Maine aurton ke sawal poochne pe kya sawal pooch liya ki sabse pehle load shedding ho gayi hai.
Sare sab against hai hamare. Sab hamare
against. No, but you know, I'm fascinated because the thing is that I keep thinking that if you are getting results, right? If the performances are fantastic and if you're getting results, then no matter how many questions questions the artist asks, it doesn't matter. You know, because agar aapko ye wala result mil raha hai, toh great. And this is why we appreciate a lot of people that we call perfectionists. But when it comes to women, there is always this thing ki sawal bahut poochti hai. Bahut sawal poochti hai. You know, and then uske baad jaake ye hota hai. Toh I find that narrative slightly problematic. And of course, you answered my question by saying that, you know, it is something that you're not going to stop to do.
Now, Smriti, I've seen when they've seen the result, they don't have a problem after that. But to get to that result, there still needs to be a certain amount of question answering that is going to happen. That probably raises eyebrows. But when they see the result, at least in my experience, it has been good that after they've seen the result, they don't question the art of asking questions.
You know, another thing that I find very interesting about the way you're handling your career is that after creating, you're a star in the Hindi film industry. You are super successful. But even after building this extremely strong position in the Hindi film industry, you've continued to work in the South. Have the roles and the films that have been put on the table in the South, has that changed with the kind of success that you got in the North?
Yeah, drastically. They almost feel it difficult to believe it's the same girl who worked in all those films that I did in South, because there was a sudden, like a different kind of respect that everyone started giving me for putting my foot down for certain kinds of films or picking up certain kind of roles. You know, one of those rare female actors jiski film mein remake ho rahi hai South mein. You know, I had Pink getting remade, Badla got remade. So they were like, it was a very beautiful space to be in, but a very, it was not a very, it was something that had happened before that often for them to understand how did it happen. So I remember when I did whatever films last couple of years, I do one film in a year in South. And they are very curious every time when I go there that why do you do these films here now? Like, I'm like, are you looking down upon your industry or you are like not sure of my intentions? I'm not able to understand why. Because I never give up on South. They just are, they're not able to, for them, the prototype has been either you work in South, you've got your stepping stone, you go to Hindi and you make it there, great, you're never coming back. Or you work in South, you make it there, you go to Hindi, you don't work out there and you come back to South. They don't have a third prototype there to actually understand where I'm coming from. So my idea, since my idea was never like I want to become the biggest Hindi film heroine. No, it was not like that. There was no planning of such sort. So that's why I'm never used South as a stepping stone. For me, that was also an experience in cinema. So is this. So why, I don't understand. I keep asking them, why do you think I should stop working in South? Because I belong to a Hindi speaking belt. That's why. But I've given my like some 6-7 odd precious years to South cinema before I made it big in Hindi. So why will I just write those 6-7 years off when I worked hard to learn the craft there? Learn the cultural understanding of South, learn the language also to a certain extent. Why will I just give up on that? And it's not like people hate me there. They have liked my films and they are still liking that one odd film I do in a year. They still receive it nicely. So why should I give up? Just because the Hindi speaking audiences are widespread than South, I don't find that a logic enough. And also somewhere it's like, I don't want to forget and be ungrateful to the place I started. That's also a reason behind going back, a more moral reason than artistic, so to say. But it is a very strong reason which is there, because I really owe a lot to them, be it, you know, for making those mistakes or helping me know the basics. I don't forget my roots that easily.
You know, Tapsee, what is also, I mean, I find you a complete convention smasher. You know, forget about the patriarchy, at least you're smashing all the conventions in the industry that exist. Because
conventions.
So, what I feel is that there's such exciting work happening in the South. The kind of cinema that even Mami shows, you know, it's a festival that programs Indian films. We don't program Hindi films. We program from all across the country. And if you already have your foot in the South, some of the best films are being made there.
Yeah.
And it's such a tremendous opportunity for an artist to be multilingual and multi-industry because, you know, you have so much more to choose from.
Yeah.
So it's a great decision. That's why I find it very interesting. Otherwise, other people are also trying to slot you in a box because they're like, oh, she's very big in Hindi. Why does she want to come and do this? Why would she give it time of day? Because she'll take another opportunity there. So well done as far as that is concerned. On Facebook, Yash Bhatia wants to know, what is the responsibility of an actor towards society? Does it affect the roles that you choose? So I think what he wants to know is that does your politics as a person come into play when you're choosing a character?
Yes, to an extent. I'll tell you why. Because, see, I'm very clear about the fact that I'm a Hindi film or an Indian film industry actor and I'm not a Hollywood actor. There's a difference. When you're doing a certain role in Hollywood, people have a very clear disconnect between the on-screen character and an off-screen character. There, people see you, a normal audience sees you like a character on screen that you portray. They don't see the actor in personal being like that. You know what happens is, like it or not, but the fact is that people see a part of their person in real, in the character that you portray, which makes you have a certain sense of responsibility of the kind of stuff that you're choosing. I'm not saying you don't have to portray gray characters or negative characters. I've done that in Badla. I've done that in Manmarziya. I am going to do that in Haseen Dilruba. I'm going to continue doing gray shades because that's what is real. But at no point, the eventual outcome of the film should make you feel like celebrating those characters. So that is where I draw the line. Because as an Indian film actor, my audience, film industry is very influential in our industry, in our country, you know, where when Salman Khan goes for a Tere Naam haircut, you walk on the road, everyone is having that haircut. The kind of influence that as an actor you can pass on people. So you should really, you know, when Shah Rukh Khan says, Pyar Dosti Hai, bloody the whole childhood went in saying Pyar Dosti Hai, Pyar Dosti Hai. So that's the kind of influence that an Indian film actor can have on your audience. So it's nice to be a little wary of that when you select roles.
That, you know, the responsibility comes into play because we are, I mean, cinema is almost like a religion in our country.
Yes, it is.
So the kind of influence that it has.
So you have to be very wary. If you're a cricketer or an actor, both of them have to be a little more wary of your public responsibility.
Can we unmute Basundhara Ghosh, please?
Hi, Basundhara.
Hi, Tapsi.
Basundhara.
Happy
Hi.
Birthday. And,
thank
I'm
you.
A big...
Thank you so much.
So, about this career switch that you did from engineering to films, I can relate very well because I have a PhD in physics. I just finished it.
Oh, wow. You're way too much educated. Like, I can't even, like, don't even think that this is similar. This is like...
No, like coming from the science background. So,
oh, okay. Only that much. That's all.
So recently I have gotten very interested in films and filmmaking, especially after I started a page on Instagram, which started doing very well, where I write about films and all those things.
Okay.
So then I'm kind of contemplating getting into filmmaking, at least learning by assisting people or like, you know, starting a new chapter in my life.
Hmm.
Chapter 2, which has nothing to do with chapter 1. So
okay.
I thought you were a good person to ask about it as to how to stay motivated to learn things from scratch, which you have no professional knowledge of. So how did you stay? Because you said you don't get attached to one particular aspect, which is also something I can relate to, because after doing a PhD, you don't expect to completely switch to something else.
Yeah. Yeah.
So what is the way to give yourself a second chance at something completely different and have that trust in yourself that you can do it?
See, first of all, the trust, the fact that you have a PhD degree, I think you should pat yourself on your back and say that you are good. Yeah. So you can make it big if you really want to. You've already done it once in one field. and you can do it again in another field. So that is a good way to begin from, like that confidence booster, right? Yeah. Now, the next thing you have to understand is learning is never going to end. So don't think that you have done something. So now your learning age is finished. Now you have to just implement things. No. Even the last breath of your life, you'll be learning something new. So you, this is a very cliche saying, but it's probably understood better as in when you go about things. The day you start believing that, okay, now I know whatever I was supposed to know for this life and that's it. And now I have to keep implementing and you can't learn, you'll stop growing as a human being.
Yeah.
So you are stunting your growth. So just have to believe that you, there's no age to learning and there is no limit to learning. And it's okay to start from scratch. You have to just accept yourself, because, you know, for me, there were many times, not just after graduation from engineering, that I had to start from scratch about learning acting. There was another moment when I was starting, when I had made a decent name in South and I had to start from scratch in Hindi. Mm-hmm. Now, that was also, again, starting from scratch moment where nobody in the Hindi film industry really paid any attention to me. They treated me like a newcomer in spite of having a filmography, because they didn't see anything of it. So that was also a learning from starting from scratch moment for me, where I had to start learning about how things happen in Hindi film industry in particular from scratch, accepting that I don't know anything about it. So you should be self-aware that you don't know anything about it and you are open to learn something new and you are okay to give it the time it deserves to learn something new. It's all, and trust me, your confidence is already there because you have proven yourself in a particular field, right? So that should be a very big confidence booster for you to believe that you have already made it. Now, whatever you're getting is bonus. Just start seeing it from that point of view. And move ahead.
Definitely. Thank you.
You know, I think, Tapsee, this is a very important point because there's so many talented people, like negating of someone's experience or someone's knowledge that has been gathered in another field. Negating that is another form of really doing injustice to a person because, you know, the thing is you have to, and you know, with you, what happened was that it was not even as if you were switching careers. You were working in South industry and then coming to North. So just treating that person as a newcomer is another thing that can possibly change about the industry. That we talk about kindness and we talk about not being harsh.
Yeah.
But also to a kind of, I call it a form of gaslighting. That, you know, just so that you can negotiate better. Or you can have an upper hand, you can tell another person ki ye to kisi aur language mein kaam kiya tha, to kuch alag hi hoga.
Hi Tapsee, my question to you is, like, I am an MBA and I'm in my last year of an MBA, and when I'm doing certain internships, there are certain things that I don't like about it, right? Like if any person's working in any industry, so I need to know that since you are in the film industry since a decade now, is there anything that you don't like about the industry and you want to change that aspect of the industry?
Of course, you know, it's impossible to like everything about a person or an industry. It's not possible. It's not real. You can't be saying that you love everything about your job or even for a person. You can't say that you will be loved by everyone. So let's just accept that. So in industry, what I feel is, you know, slightly unfair, which I don't have a solution to, honestly, is, you know, what I was telling you about, that there is not really a level playing ground for everyone, which has been, you know, a luck factor has been there, an access factor has been there. I'm not saying this, but that problem is not just with the film industry. That problem is with every industry, more or less. What I probably don't like about, that's more of an inside industry issue that I'm telling you, but I'll tell you what I don't like about my job from a larger perspective, from as an audience, including the audience. The fact that, you know, there's a very thin line between being a public figure and being a public property. Most of the times people start believing that we are public property and not a public figure, which I don't really like. You know, there's, I sometimes have to actually say it out to people that we are as normal human being as all of you. Yes, we signed up to be public figure, doesn't make us a public property. So that's one part of my job that I sometimes get difficulty in coming to terms with. So that's, you know, be it like giving a selfie at 2 a.m. On an airport, or getting people shoving cameras in my face without asking permission. There are some really bizarre things that happen. You just have to take it with a chill pill, but you know, that's what I keep requesting people to try and understand and be a little more human, that we also have our good and bad days. Yes, we are entertainers, but we are not on our job 24/7. We also have bad moments and good moments. So that thin line between public figure and public property is something that we need to respect, and I hope people understand that better.
I love that, the thin line between public property and public figure. I think that, again, you're giving me lots of t-shirt quotes, Sam Tapsi, post-lockdown.
You know, you print it all and send it to me.
It definitely. Tapsi, thank you so much for giving us so much time and so much insight.
Pleasure.
Great listening to you answer all these questions, and many congratulations on a decade in cinema. Many congratulations on the kind of, legacy work that you have created. And I hope the lockdown ends really soon, not only for all of us, but all the celebration that you need to do that is pending. And all the fantastic films we are looking forward to that you need to finish, like Haseen Dilruba. We need to see all of this. So thanks so much. Our next session is with another very talented actor called Shayoni Gupta. And Shayoni and I will be talking about Keeping It Real. She's lovely, and she's going to be joining us for a session. So do spread the word, join us, log into Facebook, give us feedback, how we can make this better. And thank you so much for joining us.